it's Kyle with Liberty.me, here with Dan Bier, master and benevolent overlord of the skeptical libertarian and the least popular man in the Jenny McCarthy household. Hey, Dan. thanks for coming on. It's good to talk to you.
Yeah, absolutely.
So about a week ago, you put up this article, the What's the Harm? The Body Count of Pseudoscience. And you say that the harm or the cost of this misinformation is just too large to ignore, sorry. And it's a holocaust of ignorance. Now, I mean, that's great, great verbiage, but is this hyperbole, or do you really believe that this is seriously one of the biggest issues, the most pressing issues facing anyone in the world today?
I absolutely do. I wasn't just doing what, you know, people at some blogs will do, which is, you know, throw up a provocative title and then sort of dial it back. I think if anything, this was the most restrained version of that article that I wrote. I call it genocidal stupidity. And I really do mean that literally. When we're talking about the misinformation being spread in Africa about condoms, about HIV/AIDS, about vaccines, about antiretroviral drugs, and a host of other important medical and scientific questions, not only in the developing world, but even in the United States and Europe, we are talking about matters of life and death. I mean, these really are questions that are the wrong answers will kill millions of children. And they are. And that is something that we cannot simply ignore or say that it's not our problem, or that, you know, if, you know, being confrontational about it or even talking about it is going to be divisive, because it might offend some people if you say that. And I think I've sort of gotten to the point where I don't really care about offending people as much as telling the truth. So, I mean, something I usually say whenever I start talking about these things is, and I guess I should throw this up front, is that I'm not being deliberately provocative. My point here is not to offend people. I'm not trying to make people angry for the sake of making people angry. I'm really worried about this, and I worry out loud on my blog, in podcasts, at conferences all over the country. And I think more people should be concerned about this than are. So I'm not being hyperbolic for the sake of being hyperbolic. I don't think I'm exaggerating. I just think it's really, really important, and it's sort of been neglected.
Sure. And I think that even if someone is wary or skeptical, of your premise about genetically engineered food, I think that almost any rational person could look at a situation like Greenpeace spreading word about genetically engineered crops being dangerous and poor African countries and other countries around the world not accepting a ton of free food because they think it's dangerous. I mean, I think almost anyone, even people who are skeptical of GMOs or genetically engineered crops, would find that obscene.
Sure. And even Greenpeace, this is kind of amusing to see them argue this on their website. But in researching the article, I went to Greenpeace because I know that activists who had been affiliated with them. In the article, I talk about there was a famine or a potential famine in southern Africa in the early 2000s. And it was the WHO estimated that something like 10 to 13 million people were at risk of starvation. So this like there were droughts, there were crop failures, there was disease and war, and there was all sorts of problems, and they really saw this coming. There were spikes in infant mortality and so on. And so the WHO organized at that point the largest relief operation in world history. I think after Iraq, the invasion of Iraq, there was a bigger one after that. But at that point, it was a huge effort. Something like 600,000 metric tons of food aid was distributed to 10 million people. But in the case of Zambia, they rejected 35,000 tons of food aid because it was potentially genetically modified. They didn't actually know whether all of it was, but because it was potentially genetically modified, despite the fact that there were millions of people on the brink of starvation in those countries, in their country, they rejected food out of hand. And Greenpeace at the time supported this. And now, they in recent years, they've sort of backed off of this because it's such a terrible story being thrown in their faces all the time that they say, if you can't get anything else, only if you have no other options and you can't extort any other organic foods out of Europe, only then should you take it. But even then, they will admit, they will say publicly, at least to donors in the West, that we did not tell people they should starve instead of get food aid. But that is the implicit choice they're making when they cheer something like 50 countries around the world have banned genetically modified foods or certain genetically modified crops. You know, there are 800 million people in the world right now who are undernourished or malnourished. And to say that, you know, government should be in the business of banning foods that have been scientifically proven to be safe merely because we think there's something unnatural about it, we just don't feel good about the idea of modifying DNA. I mean, it's incredibly stupid. And it's not just a silly thing that, you know, people who really enjoy shopping at Whole Foods can tell each other at their, you know, local Democratic meetups. I mean, this is something that has real consequences for people who are on the brink of starvation.
Sure. When Barack Obama was elected, he said that he was going to return the White House to science. It was, you know, the idea was that W. Bush was anti-science, the Republicans are anti-science, the Democrats, a lot of Democrats even trumpet their party as the party of science. Neil deGrasse Tyson and Bill Nye recently took a selfie with Barack Obama. But you think that the left's anti-science biases are worse in some ways than the right's.
Yeah, I really do. And I think I'm going to stick up a little bit for Neil deGrasse Tyson because he's made this point several times himself, which is that, you know, normally what we're talking about with Republicans being anti-science, it's usually two or three things. It's evolution. They're not so hot on evolution. Democrats aren't either. It's about a 10 or 15 point percent difference between Democrats and Republicans. Just Americans generally don't buy evolution and don't like it being taught in public schools. The good news is public schools are terrible, and so they have nothing to worry about in terms of teaching evolutionary biology. The second one is stem cell research funding. Democrats are right to complain about this. As long as the government is in the business of funding medical therapies, Congress should not be in the business of making, you know, deciding which ones get funded. You know, it should be decided on an equal basis what's a medical and scientific priority. So that's my stance on that. I'm not big on government funding science generally because I think it inherently corrupts it, but this is a good example of politics corrupting science. And the last one is global warming. And what Neil deGrasse Tyson points out that, you know, these issues aside, Republican presidents and Congresses have funded science, the National Institutes of Health, NASA, and other scientific agencies at far higher rates than Democrats have. So it's not true to say that Republicans are anti-science and Democrats are pro-science. So just in terms of public policy, they're wrong about that. And Neil, to his credit, has been very good about sort of slapping down people who want to make this a partisan issue. You know, obviously, he is liberal and he is a Democrat. So taking selfies with the president, I would take a selfie with the president. The president's
cool. Sure, sure. I mean, absolutely.
But then even if you look at the ideological divide, where people stand on science, this is really what's troubling to me because while Republicans are skeptical about global warming and evolution, Democrats are skeptical more than Republicans about vaccines, GMOs, and the pharmaceutical industry generally. in that they think that pretty much anything that Big Pharma produces is automatically suspect, even though they have created massive government bureaucracies to regulate Big Pharma, like the FDA, the EPA, and the USDA all regulate GMOs, vaccines, and new pharmaceuticals. And the incentives of these agencies are and is to restrict access to life-saving drugs. So all of their incentives are tilted towards keeping good drugs away from the market because they could potentially have side effects. So I agree, the FDA is a problem, but it's a problem because its incentives are all wrong. They're not colluding with Big Pharma to approve and push unsafe drugs on the public. If anything, they're tilted far too far in the opposite direction. So it can take 10 years is the average to get a new drug approved. That means that this year, when you see a new drug come out and the FDA and pharmaceutical companies say, this is going to save 10,000 people a year, this is going to be amazing, this is 2004 technology. This is 2004 science that we're getting today, because this is how long we have to wait for the regulatory process to work. So that really does bug me. So you end up with liberals who are, they hate vaccines, they hate genetic modification to increase crop yields and lower food prices, and they support big government bureaucracy, which arguably hurts people by keeping life-saving drugs away from them, not by pushing dangerous drugs onto the public.
Sure, so, and if anyone wants to see...
I should say, sorry.
Oh, go ahead.
Not all people on the left are like this. Many of them are very committed, many good skeptics. Skeptics are primarily left-leaning, more inclined to be liberal than conservative or libertarian, and they've done a very good job of sticking up for this. But by and large, these are much bigger problems on the left, and their purity concerns about nature and the holiness of the ecological environment than they are on the right. And they have much more serious consequences for human life, I think.
Sure, sure. And if anyone wants to see the effects of that FDA regulation on pharmaceuticals, just watch Dallas Buyers Club and look at how long it took to get, you know, life-saving AIDS drugs to people.
Yeah, absolutely. One of the things that I found most troubling about Dallas Buyers Club, which I thought was great and everyone should see it because I like Matthew McConaughey, but he's really...
All right.
Oh, yeah. Well, one of the things I found most troubling about it was that many of the treatments that the protagonist gets in from Mexico, vitamins and so forth, they really were basically placebos. We know that now. And we know that it probably didn't do a whole lot in terms of actually stopping HIV from replicating or spreading. But what was most concerning about that is, you know, you see him overdose on drugs that he gets illegally in the black market. And, you know, his patients are being, you know, injected by people who are not doctors. No doctor will prescribe these drugs to him. None will help oversee them because they'll lose their license. So basically, by creating this environment where the DEA, the FDA, the AMA, and all of these national bureaucracies basically keep people away from doctors, desperate people who have nothing else to lose, trying everything they can. And, you know, that's – I don't think there's anybody in America who really thinks that that's what we should be using our government to do. But – because these people are trying unapproved drugs and unapproved treatments and unapproved therapies, and many of them, you know, really didn't do much. But what was much worse was keeping them away from doctors who could oversee them and monitor their progress and help them make rational, informed choices. But, you know, you see his best friend in the movie won't help him, won't write prescriptions for his vitamin supplements that he's coming in. Because she will lose her license and she will lose all the good that she's trying to do. So it's not the doctor's fault, and it's not the drug company's fault. It really is the institution and the system holding people back and keeping them away from an open dialogue with their doctors.
When a politician picks up a scientific issue as a pet project and tries to popularize it, and moves it into the political realm, does that action irreparably damage the scientific process in regards to that issue? I think of Al Gore and global warming immediately. Do you agree?
Not inherently, no. Mostly because I think that the social sciences are actually science. Mm. Something that people on the left also don't understand, which I think is another part of the problem of left-wing science denial, is the idea that economics is actually science and, you know, has something to tell us about what the government can reasonably accomplish in terms of various public policy goals. But there is something to be said about the politicization of science and scientific funding. I think of, you know, and you know, obviously I'm concerned about that. The issue of global warming is maybe a little bit more complicated, but we could perhaps get onto that later. But I think the biggest problem is scientific illiteracy and misunderstanding among the public. It's not that, you know, these stupid celebrities and politicians are coming along and you know, inflicting bad science on us. They are responsible for that to a large degree. But in the 2008 campaign, John McCain, I think Michelle Bachmann and Sarah Palin and Barack Obama and Joe Biden, actually. I know McCain and Obama for sure, and Bachmann. The other ones I don't remember specifically. But they all came out and basically pandered to fears about vaccines, which were much more in the public mind at that time. And it was brutally irresponsible, absolutely reprehensible on so many levels. You know, they really do share responsibility for children getting vaccine-preventable diseases in the United States. It was, those quotes were endlessly repeated by anti-vaccine people. You know, you can trust him. He's one of us. He's John McCain, or he's Barack Obama. You know, you can trust him. He's one of our guys, and he knows what he's talking about. And they both came out and said just really stupid things about vaccines. Why did they do that? Does Barack Obama really think that vaccines cause autism? I don't know. Maybe. But what he does know, and what I absolutely am convinced of, is that saying that you're concerned that vaccines cause autism is good for you in the press, good for you in the polls. You're identifying with voters. You're saying, here's the thing that you care about. I care about that, too. So politicians are a reflection of our problem. You know, it's a feedback loop, but politicians are a reflection of ignorance among the public. I mean, this is what democracy really does well, is translate popular ignorance into really weaponized public policy.
Definitely.
So, yeah. So I mean, the issue of global warming, you know, Al Gore has done generated much heat and little light on that question. But I think the reason why he's popular and the reason why people pay attention to him isn't just that he's the vice president, but it's that he is telling people, he's confirming fears that people already have. So they go to him when they want to have their biases about the environment and pollution confirmed.
I think that's a really good point about Al Gore. Why do you think that people latch on to conspiracy theories and pseudoscience? Do they just want to believe something? I mean, I don't think people are stupid. What do you think? Why do you think they latch on?
There's a sort of a cottage industry of psychologists and pundits who want to find out, like, what's the one cause? Like, what is it that makes people believe these things? And my former colleague, Jesse Walker, who writes for Reason, just wrote a book called The United States of Paranoia. I have it here on my desk. A point that he makes is that there's not just one cause, and trying to isolate one cause for a very diverse category of beliefs is just silly, and you're likely to, first of all, insult lots of people. They do it because they're afraid. Yeah, but we're all afraid of something. I'm afraid of anti-vaccine people not vaccinating their children and spreading disease to people who are immunocompromised. I'm afraid of that. But I would be rather insulted if anyone said that's why I, believe the science on vaccines. So there's lots of different reasons that do it, that contribute to the problem. I think most of them are, the reasons why we believe anything. My friend Michael Shermer wrote a book called The Believing Brain, which basically tries to identify tendencies, like how do we form beliefs? We connect the dots from A to B, and sometimes A is connected to B, but sometimes it's a misfiring. The logic that we use to form beliefs about most things breaks down in certain circumstances. So we end up committing lots of, cognitive biases and logical fallacies in how we think about these things. And, so take the example of HIV/AIDS conspiracies. There's lots of reasons why people in South Africa and even, maybe 10% of people in the United States believe conspiracies about the origins of HIV or the treatment of AIDS. A lot of it has to do with the fact that the United States government and the South African government for years did really evil things in bioweapons programs, in testing on unauthorized testing on people who didn't know they were being experimented on. The U.S. government's syphilis studies at Tuskegee and at Willowbrook of African American men who were just given placebos instead of actual treatment for syphilis because they wanted to see what will happen. If we just let these people die over the natural course of the disease, absolutely evil, absolutely reprehensible. And this did incalculable harm to trust in doctors, in the medical establishment, in public health organizations, and in the government. So, governments do share a large share of the responsibility for creating mistrust of public health organizations. So some of it is just reasonable concern. And then into that concern rushes, a bunch of people called, culturepreneurs, people who make lots of money by selling, by capitalizing on these fears and selling junk cures to people. Think of naturalnews.com, they'll sell you any conspiracy theory about doctors or science or the government, and then here's a link to buying our overpriced crap, our snake oil. It's a huge industry. It's absolutely a huge industry. So there's that. My friend, he smoked for 60 years and he didn't have lung cancer, so the government's lying about that. Or my friend took, wormwort and snake oil and her eczema cleared up, and my doctor doesn't believe me, so I don't trust him about that. And so there's lots of different things that feed into this. Because there's just lots of different ways that our thinking process about certain questions can go wrong. And this is the importance of science. I guess this is the bottom line here, is the reason why we trust science is not because scientists are some glorified, exalted class of people, and whatever any one of them says goes, or whatever any doctor says goes. I mean, Andrew Wakefield, the guy who faked the MMR autism connection study, he was a doctor. I mean, he's not anymore. He's been stripped of his medical license for lying to the public and causing a huge measles outbreak in Britain. It's not about individuals, it's about the process. It's about the institutions of peer review, of doing large studies that are then subjected to criticism, are subjected to competitive review by other scientists, are just generally checked and balanced and rechecked over and over and over again. And the process isn't perfect. But when we look to the body of literature, what does the consensus of evidence point to? The consensus of evidence is hundreds and thousands of studies have shown that commercially available genetically modified crops are indistinguishable in their nutritional and health effects to so-called organic crops. The consensus of evidence proves that vaccines notice it's always just vaccine. Any vaccines or the MMR vaccine or what vaccine, but vaccines do not cause autism. We don't know exactly what causes autism, but we know it doesn't, and it's vaccines. You know, the consensus of evidence proves that HIV evolved from SIV, the simian immunodeficiency virus, you know, several times during the 1950s, it jumped the species barrier. And we know that it causes acquired immune deficiency syndrome. We know that HIV causes AIDS. So you can find any quack, you know, there's thousands of doctors and scientists in the world, and you can find anyone to support anything. But when you look to the body of science and the consensus of evidence, that's really what we should be putting our confidence in. Because when you get on an airplane, you trust science. You know it works because you're in the air and you're not falling out of here. And, you know, seatbelts work in cars. Vaccines work in our bodies. We know how it works. And I think this is really what I want people to understand, is that your intuition is not enough. You need solid scientific evidence.
That's incredible stuff, Dan. And we really appreciate you coming on. Love to have you back in the future. I mean, seriously, great stuff.
Awesome. Anytime.
All right. Have a great day.
You too, Kyle.